the last 3 years, Cerion started to build an analytical lab to fully characterize the materials that we are making. So, and I would like to share with you today my experiences over the last 3 years on running that lab. So the key to run an analytical lab is to understand the surface chemistry of the nanoparticles, understand how the size of the nanoparticles may affect your measurement parameters, and then also the size limitation of the instrument you're using. To build for success, you have to invest at least in a minimum of equipment and expertise to run it, or you partner with a firm who has made that investment. Essential to a successful business is to have good quality data, because they will guide your research, they will guide your scale up, and you have to have the good quality data in a timely manner and in a cost-effective manner. Now, what does it take to build a successful lab? So first, there is a significant financial investment. So Cerion invested in capital, and we have annual operating costs. Now, operating costs, they go into proper staffing, into routine performance maintenance, preventative maintenance, performance verification, and chemicals. So the standards that you need for performance verification, they can add up in cost quite easily. And the other thing is to manage, you have to be well organized, so that you have to have, that you have your routine performance verification, routine preventative maintenance, your SOPs, everything has to be in place, has to be done, so that you don't have any downtimes, so that you have, and that you can assure a short turnaround time. So it's short turnaround time is part of the reason why you make this investment to begin with. Staffing, you need to have the expertise to run the equipment. Some equipments are easier to run than others, but certainly for the more complex equipment like TEM, it's not trivial to get good and useful data out of it. So how to characterize your nanomaterials? This is an extensive list of parameters going with instruments that you need to fully characterize the material. Most of them are not specific to nano, but they extend very easily, very nicely into the nano range. The good news is you don't need to measure each one of these parameters, but you need to understand which parameters are important, so which parameters are crucial for the performance of your material. Yeah? Not so much what can you measure, but what do you need to measure that relates directly to performance of your material. So you very likely will come out with like two, maybe three parameters that are really crucial, and those parameters will guide your research, will guide your development through scale-up and into manufacturing. Now this, as I said, this is a general list for a general characterization of your materials. For specific applications like optical application, magnetic, electronic, you will have specialized instruments. Greatest challenge for measuring nanoparticles is the size. Reason being, nanoparticles, because of the high surface area, which comes with a high surface energy, they just love to agglomerate. It's very difficult to keep them apart. That's why you find most true nanoparticles in a dispersion of one sort or another. Very few true nanoparticles exist as a powder, if any. So most of them are in this dispersion. Now for analyzing for size, often done by light scattering or by TEM, you need to dilute them. Very most likely you need to dilute them. So if you dilute your dispersion, you change the chemistry, and the risk is that the dispersion may no longer be stable. They may just crash out, they're agglomerated, and you do not really measure what you have originally had in the dispersion. So for this, you need to understand the chemistry, and as I said, the surface chemistry, so that you know how to dilute it, yeah, what medium to use to dilute it down. Another challenge is the refractive index. Everybody working with optical nanoparticles knows that refractive index does change with particle size. So now for static light scattering, you need to have the correct refractive index to get the correct size out of it. So you want to make sure you have the right RI, and you always want to compare with SEM or TEM data, which will tell you if you have, if you're measuring the correct size. Another problem for light scattering, for dynamic light scattering, is the stabilizer around the particle. this may give you false large particle sizes. So again, you have to compare with TEM, SEM to know that what you're measuring is correct. So you set your measurement parameters, you check them a couple times, and then when you're good, you just go with the same parameters for the same material. Another challenge is structure, morphology, composition. And composition here means if you really want to know your nanoparticle composition, is the dopant uniformly dispersed in the nanoparticle? Is it just clumping up on the side? You can get those answers, TEM, high-resolution TEM, and TEM XRF, or EDX. They are great in getting you the images, and also great in seeing how the dopant is uniformly distributed in your nanoparticle. EELS, electron energy loss spectroscopy, is another method. Now, these are highly specialized. The instruments are expensive. The expertise to run them is expensive. So submitting a sample, getting one measurement done becomes very expensive. And that's the challenge here, not to get the nice pictures, to pay for them. That's the challenge. So you need to understand on what, like the perfect distribution of your dopant in the nanoparticle, what performance parameter it correlates to. And most likely those performances are easier, simpler to measure, less expensive to measure. And so you want to go with those measurements to guide your research. And only if you need to for troubleshooting, or just to get nice pictures for a publication, that's when you want to go with TEM or these more fancier methods. Now, as a business, you want to find what's the right solution for you. The best thing is to, if you have at least the key instruments in-house, and as I said, one, two, maybe three instruments, and they may not have to be that expensive, but you want to understand your material, the application, and get those key instruments in-house, if you can, and get the right personnel, the right expertise to run them. The other option is to outsource with an analytical company, an analytical service company. They are available, fairly abundant, I would say. They tend to be specialized to life science, environmental science, and also into nanoscience. And among nanoscience, again, they are specialized into whatever it is on the nanoscale that you're interested in. So you can outsource. You can partner with a university, so especially if you have something that's of academic interest, something novel that you're making. So universities, you may be able to find a university lab that's interested in exactly what you're doing, and they can help you often with analysis, with analytical instruments. They also, some universities also tend to provide it as a service, so provide analysis as a service. So you can partner with the university, you send them samples, they analyze, send you back the data. It is much less expensive, a lot less expensive than a professional analytical lab. Downside possibly is long turnaround times, because it's mostly a student running the samples, and when finals come up, then your sample will wait. Another possibility is, of course, you partner with a company that has the equipment in-house, and it's also specialized for research, development, scale-up manufacturing. So actually knows or has a pretty good idea on what you're trying to accomplish and can help you through. So when you outsource, you definitely want to evaluate two or three providers, send them a sample or a couple samples where you know the parameters, you know the properties, so see what results come back, see how well they analyze, characterize your material, how well it agrees with reality, and also see on how well you can work with them. So how easy they are to work with in information exchange, because when you outsource or when you partner, you have to build a good relationship with the company that you're working with. In-house advantage, as I said, so if you can, you want to bring at least the crucial equipment in-house, because the advantages are just significant. Yeah. So you have direct access to the resource, you have full control over the analytical resource, meaning manufacturing, a problem comes up, everything has to drop, and your samples have to be run. So with in-house analyticals, you can do that. You have a close interaction between the researcher, the development engineer, and the analytical specialists to really tailor the analysis to what you need, what you're looking for, and understanding on both sides. What does the researcher want? what is the instrument capable of? So this interaction is invaluable, yeah, to get the most of the instrument and get the most information. It's a smooth technology transfer, of course, because you have you build up your knowledge on the material, on the instrumentation, what it can and cannot do, and that grows through development and scale up. And all of this, of course, relates to shortened product cycle times and also for quality control, shorter product release times. A list of the equipment that we have at Cerion, so it's a pretty long list. We have that many different instruments because we have many different materials. So we're not specialized to one type of material, where we only need like a handful of instruments. Since we are a scale-up company and we have customers coming to us with whatever the customer has, and it keeps changing, so we have a large selection of instruments to be able to fully characterize what we have. Yeah. With this, I'm at the end of my presentation, and thank you very much for listening. Thank you.